Daniels in for Kathleen Sullivan this morning. Very few rock musicians have been as controversial as Frank Zappa. Even the name he's given his children have raised a few eyebrows. But there is no controversy about his talent or about his role as a rock and roll innovator.
So today we will be at home with Frank Zappa. Frank, how are you this morning?
Boy, you know, I don't like to get up this early, that's for sure.
And we're off to a good start. Well, you look well, and we'll be chatting with you in just a bit.
Okay.
First, now the news.
4 minutes before the hour. Next, Friday at Home with Frank Zappa.
With someone special, and this morning we go to the Hollywood Hills and the home of a man who once said, "I never set out to be weird, it was always other people who called me weird." A man who was the embodiment of the 60s, dubbed the Rasputin of rock and roll. This morning we are at home with Frank Zappa. Frank Vincent Zappa, the oldest of four children, was born 48 years ago in Baltimore, Maryland, to Francis and Rose Marie Zappa, who were of Sicilian, Greek, Arab, and French descent. Frank was a sickly young boy, and so the Zappas went west in search of a healthier climate and settled in Lancaster, California, where Frank formed his first band, the Blackouts. By 1966, the Mothers of Invention was born. The band set out on an uncharted musical course.
Do you think that I creep in the night and sleep in a phone booth?
For the next 14 years, the group went through numerous personnel changes, but the controversial and satirical Zappa sounds remained. In 1967, he married Gail Slotman. They're still married. They have four children, Moon Unit, Dweezil, Amit, and Diva. Zappa's musical history includes more than 50 LPs, running the gamut from The Grand Wazoo and Lumpy Gravy to Jazz from Hell, which won a Grammy in 1987, to his own classically oriented compositions, which he recorded with the London Symphony. In court, testifying against censorship of rock lyrics, Zappa is as outspoken as he is on stage. After 4 years away from the stage, Zappa completed a world tour in 1988 for his newest release, Broadway the Hard Way. And just out is the Real Frank Zappa book for the benefit of those who might have misunderstood the Zappa mind. And right now, Frank Zappa, mind and body, is in his home in the Hollywood Hills, where we join him this morning. Morning, Frank.
Morning.
We are checking with our at-home-with archivist, and we think this may, in fact, be the first time we've had an at-home-with segment with a person in a bathrobe, so...
Really?
Yeah.
You know what time it is here? You want to see me in a suit and tie at this hour of the morning?
What part of your house are we in right now?
We're sitting in the basement.
And is this somebody has suggested this is your video room?
Well, there's video equipment in here. I review tapes in here. There's a bunch of videotapes around the room. And usually I do all the interviews in this room.
Yeah. What do you watch? Do you watch TV ever?
Sure, I like to watch the news, and I like to watch C-SPAN.
C-SPAN?
Yeah.
Do you watch MTV or VH1 or any of that sort of stuff?
Well, I've occasionally seen it, but I usually try and whiz by those channels.
You are a grazer, then, I take it.
Actually, I'm a pole vaulter when it comes to those ones.
I need to ask you a little bit about some of the stuff that's in the room. Behind you, there are some license plates, which I guess is an ironic thing to have up on the wall, in that I don't think... When was the last time you had a regular driver's license?
1967. I don't drive.
You don't?
These are gifts that fans have sent to me. And this is only a few of them. You know, I'm a little bit lax in putting the stuff up on the wall.
Why'd you write this book?
Because Ann Patty said it would be really easy.
Was it?
No.
And so what was it like to do it then?
Well, the part, see, when she told me it was going to be easy, Peter Occhio Grosso was going to do these interviews, and, you know, I just talk into a tape recorder, and then he was going to go away, and I would have a book. But after the tapes were transcribed and I saw the way it looked, it just didn't sound like me on paper. So I went into a little room with a word processor, and 3 months later I had rewritten the book.
Is this sort of the truth about Frank Zappa? I mean, is this as kind of an attempt to demythologize?
Huh?
Take the myth out of yourself?
Taking the myth out of myself. No, I've tried to take the myth out of myself regularly over the last 25 years, but the real reason for doing the book is not the biographical stuff in the front, it's the little essays in the back.
As I look around the room behind you there, there's a huge caricature, and it says something, Honker Home Video. What's that?
That's another one of our little cottage industries that we operate out of the house and out of a warehouse in the San Fernando Valley.
You are really quite an entrepreneur. I guess if people think of you in terms of being out of the mainstream, you really are in the mainstream in a lot of ways, and the way you sort of conduct your business.
Well, I think it's mainstream and maybe even trendy today to be entrepreneurial. It's something else to stick with it and manage to earn a living from it, and that's one of the interesting things about my career, is that doing things which are a little bit off the wall, I've managed to earn a living.
Is it important to you to have control of all of that stuff yourself?
Sure, because who else is going to take care of it? Nobody else would care about it.
Can you get records made in this day and age? Can Frank Zappa make a record for a big commercial record company and get it promoted?
Well, that's just a matter of cash and payoffs, actually. But you know, I can make any kind of record that I want. I have my own record company, and then that company is distributed through Capitol. But the deal that I have with them involves no promotion. They don't do anything but press it and ship it out and then collect from the retailers.
You got a Grammy for Jazz from Hell. Does that mean anything extra to you?
Well, I think that it's living proof that the whole process is a fraud. This is a little plastic joke, the Grammy itself. I got it for a song called Jazz from Hell, which I'm convinced nobody has ever heard. And I don't know why they gave me a Grammy for this song. It was the most obscure track on a CD called Jazz from Hell.
Frank Zappa, we're visiting with in the Hollywood Hills this morning. We will return and talk some more in just a bit. It's 15 minutes before the hour. Hollywood Hills and our visit at home with rock performer and composer Frank Zappa. We're in a different part of the house. Looks like you've got an entire studio set up there.
That's right.
I'll just
walk over here.
Yeah, let's look around a little bit.
Yeah.
There's something you're sitting by now that I'm not even sure how to pronounce it. Can you explain it?
Well, it's a machine called the Synclavier, which is, this is the machine that produced that Grammy Award-winning song, Jazz from Hell.
that everyone is humming on the way to work this morning. What does the machine do? How does it work?
Well, it allows you to perform on the keyboard. You could play a composition on the keyboard, which is then stored in the computer memory, and then you edit what you played, or you can type in information on this keypad here and edit what you played.
Now, does the computer in some way, shape, or form create musical voices? Can you, I suppose, like trumpets or violins or whatever?
Yeah, you can have any kind of instrument you want, and that's done through sampling.
Yeah. Do you think a Beethoven or a Brahms or a Mozart would compose this way if they had access to this kind of machinery?
Well, if they didn't, they'd be missing out. It's a great machine, and it allows you to do a lot of work fast.
Yeah.
It's like a word processor for music.
Do you ever think, though, the stuff, the electronics and the microchips can kind of get in the way, though, of the actual true music itself or what you're really trying to get at?
No, actually it improves it by subtracting the human element, which is the most unreliable part of doing music. If you've ever employed a musician, you know what I mean.
I thought that was supposed to be part of the creative process, though.
Employing musicians? Well, no.
You have worked with major symphonies, you've written lots of music, you've looked at the works and studied the works of important modern composers. Is it important to you to be taken seriously in that regard?
No.
You've done that work, though. When you work with those people, how does it feel to have them respond
to you? With a guy in a tuxedo? You know, it's kind of like going to a banquet, except you don't eat.
Well, except, isn't it something more than that? I mean, these people are real artists. You're talking about people like a Zubin Mehta or somebody like that.
Well, of course, you know, you have to take the people as they come. Individual conductors and performers can be alternately charming or boring. And just because a guy's got a tuxedo on is no sure sign that he's an artist or a fine person. And I've seen both kinds in the orchestral world. Same way in rock and roll. Just because a guy's got a nice leather suit doesn't mean he can really rock.
Who do you like? Who do you respect?
Give me a classification.
Rock and roll.
Well, I think my favorite guitar player working in rock and roll today would be Alan Holdsworth.
And who does he work with, for those of us
who don't know?
Managed to age out of some, or lose
we'll
touch.
We'll just keep that a secret. This, you know, it's his group, Alan Holdsworth.
Okay. Then what about, and what about classical music?
In classical music, my favorite composers are Stravinsky, Webern, Bartok, guys like that.
Yeah. Are there any people, have you ever heard the music of, like, the minimalists, you like Philip Glass? Are you in touch with that sort of stuff?
I've never heard a piece by Philip Glass, but in general, I don't like minimalist music.
What do you listen to around the house?
I don't have much recreational listening time. Basically, if I'm listening to something, I'm listening to what I'm working on in the studio.
Yeah. You have four kids. We see your son sometimes on TV. Are you a good dad?
I guess I'm okay. None of the kids are in jail.
And do you have a philosophy, a parenting philosophy?
Well, this is revealed in minute detail in the book, but I could sum it up for you, and you're probably not going to enjoy it. In the part that says how to raise fantastic children, the secret clue is keep them as far away from religion as possible.
And that's the key, you think, or what else? So didn't you say you should let kids grow like weeds?
Yeah, let them grow like weeds, but keep them away from a church. Let me make this very clear.
Choosing
a religion is important, okay?
Right.
And this is not something that should be inflicted on a child from birth. And I think that if you let a child choose which way he wants to go, which religion or no religion or whatever he wants to do, that decision should be made by the child at the point where the child has enough data to make that decision.
Do you think you want your kids to grow up to be musicians?
If they want to. I think my daughter, the youngest daughter, is probably going to be more interested in mathematics.
Frank Zappa, thanks so much for letting us come into your home and visit with you this morning.
Okay, Harry, see ya.
Take care.